I was born in Springfield, Illinois, land of Lincoln. And the funny thing is, I was born on Abraham Lincoln's birthday. So the old joke is that my mom used to tell me that she almost named me Abrahama, which actually Wynn-Anne is almost as strange, but we used to laugh about that. How I started composing is that my mom, who was not a musician, when I was about 3 years old, she used to coax me to the piano. She would have me sit at the piano with her, and we would do stories together. And she would be the dinosaur, and I would be the little bird, or she would be the kangaroo, and I would be the hopping frog. And we would make up stories together, and I learned very young that underneath the piano keys was this landscape for the imagination. I didn't know where middle C was. I didn't know how to sit at the piano, but I found out that I could create through the piano keys. And that's why I'm a composer today. So I owe it to my mom. I was a very curious kid. And my mom put me into piano lessons at about five with a neighborhood piano teacher, and I didn't last very long there because I think I was constantly asking why. She would show me a major chord and I would say, why is that important? And I think I drove her crazy. So my mom took me to the second piano teacher, who was a jazz instructor who lived quite a long distance away. And he introduced me to lots of different things. He discovered that I have perfect pitch. And so he would say, when you hear a train go by, notice what pitch they're on. This is when I was very little. Notice what chord they're playing. Notice the sounds in nature and how they work in your head. And put a name on them. So it opened my ears to the natural world, and I heard the world differently. And he answered why. So when he would show me the primary chords, I would say, why do I need to know the primary chords? I don't really even like the sound of them. And he'd say, well, the primary chords are the basis for the harmony behind 1500 up folk songs. So it's good to know your primary chords, but you don't have to use them if you don't like them. So I learned my primary chords and then left them behind at some point. So being curious was good. After I went to the jazz instructor, I went to another teacher when I was about 10, and she was the incredible teacher who loved everything that I did and made me feel like I could do anything. So I got to a certain level with her and felt really good about music, wanted to be the musician for the rest of my life. Then she sent me to the difficult piano teacher when I was in eighth grade. At that point, I left every lesson crying, feeling like I couldn't do anything. But this last final teacher before I went on to college taught me and took me to a level that was way beyond where any of my other teachers took me, which was to that deep level of listening. A gift that I had from the early ages, which was to listen to the natural world, to listen to my own playing, to take it to a deeper level, so that it wasn't just notes and rhythms, it wasn't just things on the page, it was about sound. Music is about the love of sound. So pulling out that sound from hearing, listening, always listening to what I made and also listening to what the world makes is the basis for composition. I think one of my greatest gifts as a human being, we all have those gifts, I think one of my greatest gifts is I'm able to take really complex ideas and simplify, bringing them down to a single grain. Like counterpoint in my Creative Composition Toolbox series, I'm able to bring that into a simple definition of two sentences. There are volumes written about counterpoint. Same thing with the Latin series. I'm able to take really complex sounds and bring them down into a book that doesn't use eighth notes. So one of my gifts is really making very complex issues into very simple issues. I think that's the teacher in me. I think I've always been a teacher. That's something that I just can do. I'm able to also connect to kids. That's incredibly important as a teacher. If you can't really listen to where a kid is coming from, you're not going to be able to give them what they need. So when a student comes in and sits at the piano and they've had a bad day and they start to cry, you have to figure out how to get through to them in a musical way. You're not their therapist, although you feel like it sometimes. You're not their therapist, but you are there to provide music to them in a valuable way. So reaching that kid, being intuitive enough to know what that child needs, is extremely important as a teacher. And I love teaching. I love teaching. I started teaching when I was a teenager. My teacher went on some kind of journey for 3 months, and in the summer I took on her students. I was 16, I believe, and I found out it was really fun. So when I took on my own piano studio, it was natural to me. It felt good. What I love the most about teaching is not just bringing these simple kernels down and teaching the information to these students. What I love the most is the connection with the students, that valuable relationship that develops over the years. Having many years as a private teacher, 8, 10, 12 years to really, really create a bond of mentorship that will change both of you through the years. These are moments, not just friendships, but they're musical relationships, which is very deep emotionally and very valuable to me as a teacher. If I were to give a piece of advice to my younger self, I think I would choose not to give a piece of advice. I would choose to bring compassion to my younger self. I was hard on myself, as many young people are. Life is very, very long. We always say life is short. It's not. It's really long. So mistakes happen all the time. And if you keep the ball rolling, mistakes turn into beautiful music. It happens at the keyboard all the time. I will be investigating ideas, and I'll go in a direction that I'm used to, and it sounds pretty good. And then all of a sudden I'll make a mistake. And I could say, ugh, that's a bad mistake, ugh. But if I trust that mistake, I can go in a completely new direction and find that surprise, which I love surprises. And if I follow that mistake, all of a sudden I've got better music. So mistakes are good. You know, I spend so much of my life telling young students and students of all ages that they have a voice, that they have something to say. And then I go to the piano and I listen and I spend all this personal time creating music. And then I go out into the world and find out that I actually have a voice. That's like a shock that people want to hear what I have to say. That's very fulfilling to me. It's also amazing that people actually want to hear the music that I write, because I don't write it really for other people. I write it because it's so much fun to do. So it starts as a personal experience. Then it becomes so much more, because I go out and find that this person likes this piece and this person was changed by this piece, and I realize that it has impact, and that's very fulfilling.